Hi everyone, I'm Andy Beadle. I work for BASF Agricultural Solutions, and my passion is sustainable agriculture, but sustainable agriculture in practice. And what we see around us here is farmers working for the benefit of biodiversity, in essence.
Okay.
So really what we're doing here is farming biodiversity, we're farming insects, we're doing stuff for soil health, because farmers are at the forefront of really understanding the benefits that this sort of activity brings to their farming operations.
But you talk about farming biodiversity, I think, so it's not just letting something sit and hope something will come up and flowers at the end of the day?
No, the secret is to manage it. So this is a permanent biodiversity strip.
Okay.
So there is something here all year round. What we're seeing flowering today is fennel. This is fennel. We're seeing wild carrot. But if you'd come down here in the spring, you'd have seen completely different species. Mm. And the reason being is that we need to balance the food for the insects, for the birds, right across the year, not just on a beautiful sunny day in August.
And it's not only, let's say, there's specific biodiversity for the Palatines, for our region, so depending where you are,
sure,
it really changes, right?
Exactly. I mean, the key for a good biodiversity strip is to feed the indigenous species.
Yes.
So these are indigenous species for where we are. They're feeding the local insects. If we went to northern Germany, we would see something different. If we went to the UK, you wouldn't see so much fennel, for example.
Okay. And what are you doing, or what we at BASF doing really to help farmers now to find the right biodiversity, the right, you know, the mixture of flowers, when to grow, what which will also fit into their natural habitat?
We actually go one step back,
okay,
and actually work with the farmer by looking at a field and saying to the farmer, what is the most productive part of this field?
Mm-hmm.
Because this field here, it wasn't randomly chosen. It was chosen as a biodiversity strip because it is a strange shape.
Okay.
You can't see, but if you were to go above, it's a very tight rectangle, triangle.
Triangle,
which means that if you're trying to get his machinery in here, very difficult, number one. On the other side of these reeds, and it goes all the way around the back, is also water. There's a big stream in here. And this land is sloping this way. So the farmer would look at this and say, okay, it's probably the most difficult bit of land I've got.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably the least productive because it floods. And because he's a responsible farmer, he's also trying to ensure that the soil that he has here stays here and doesn't end up in the river.
Okay.
So if it was bare and it rained,
it would have been erosion into the...
Exactly. So we do those sorts of things. We as BASF speak with farmers, we have these conversations, and we say, actually take this sort of land out of production because it'll probably make the bit over there more productive.
Okay.
And then let us give you some advice on the sorts of plants that we could be growing in here.
So in principle, it is not only this land, but it also really is affecting the whole productivity of the farm.
Yeah. In many ways, because if we were to take this as one field and we pretend it was a wheat field,
mm-hmm,
and I'd come up to the farmer and I'd say, what's your average yield? And they say 8.2 tons,
yeah,
let's say. But what within that 8.2 tons is some that's four,
mm-hmm,
and there's some in the middle.
It's which, 10 or whatever, right?
Exactly. So you say to him, well, why are you farming land that actually costs you money?
Yeah.
To farm, because if your break even is 6 tons per hectare,
then you're losing money on this end.
Exactly. So we can do something much more productive here, and he can then concentrate all of his wheat activities in the productive area.
And this is now one piece of land, and if you, let's say, talk to farmers and recommend and help them maybe to steward the land better and find the right spots, and you mentioned already the stream on this side,
yeah,
how important do you see that those small little ecosystems are somewhat connected? Is this
absolutely vital? I mean, we're talking things that move around. I mean, the camera's looking at us, but if it was behind us, it'd see all these birds, these swallows flying around. They don't just stay here, they fly around all over the show. So they need interconnected parcels of land,
okay,
to feed on.
Yeah.
The insects need interconnected parcels of land to move around in. This is just beautiful here because we've got this corridor going all the way around the edge. And actually, if we were to walk further in, we'd also see some other little pockets that the farmers put in place. And they act like motorway service stations.
Okay. Yeah.
So if an insect's on a journey...
That's a pit stop in a different way.
It's a pit stop. So here we have a ladybird, for example.
Yeah, and interesting enough, I think what you would normally would expect, really flower strip, you know, yellow and blue and poppies, etc., etc., flying around. And it looks really different from what you're expecting. But of course, as you said, it's about when is the right timing, what is really flowering, and how do we go from there?
I mean, a lot of people are surprised and they would say, well, it can't be good for insects because there's no beautiful, colourful flowers in there. What we have to remember is a lot of the flowers we have in our garden, which we grow for colour, come from different parts of the world.
Yeah, so, and they don't normally don't feed insects.
Exactly,
you know, it's just
exactly.
Ornamental for...
I mean, I don't know if we can, if these are in full flower yet, but... Not yet, but once they are, this will be alive with
bees. Of course, you see flies
bees
and some kind of
bees.
Wild bees on that.
Exactly, yeah.
That's true. But now we are here in Germany, and the question for me is, you know, first of all, what kind of responsibility are you taking, you know, as BASF, as crop protection industry? Because normally you would say, hey, come on, we are here to improve the yield on this part of the land, rather the biodiversity yield on this part of the land.
Yeah, but the two are totally interconnected. Because, yes, we are there to improve yield over there, but we don't just attract stuff in here because they like being here. Mm. They actually play a very vital role, not just here, but out there. Mm. So this would be full, once it's in flower, of parasitoidal wasps.
Yeah.
If that was a wheat field, and it was still growing, those wasps would be eating all of the aphids, for example. What's going on down here in the soil is that we're continuously churning over organic matter. So we're building up carbon content in here, which improves the soil biodiversity, which then moves out over there. And if you've got better biodiversity, you've got better yield.
And also you said this, maybe in between, saying you're also storing carbon, right?
We're also storing carbon, yeah. This is carbon. All of this is carbon. If we were to pull its roots up... I can't get it up, it's too dry. It's stored already. But I mean, yeah, the roots are storing carbon.
Yeah.
And we're not disturbing this field. This field has not been disturbed for 5 years. So that carbon in the roots...
There's no tillage at all, nothing, right?
Nothing.
It stays.
It stays as
in. So we're building up more black soil. Well, not really black soil, but more carbon-rich soil.
Much more carbon-rich soil here, okay. Through these sorts of activities. And what we would probably also do in terms of if we were talking with farmers about how to increase the yield even in their wheat field, is talk to them about how do you look after your soil after the wheat?
Yeah.
Because what we're seeing here is a soil that is always covered. We would like to see the same in a wheat field. So you grow what we call a cover crop in between wheat and your next crop.
Carbon, nitrogen, plus of course, you know, no erosion or limited erosion.
Exactly, and that's putting also stuff back in the soil.
So something I think we also should introduce Charlie.
Yeah. This is our biodiversity sniffer-outer, if you want. This is Charlie, and Charlie comes with me everywhere when I'm off looking at biodiversity. Had he and I been here on our own and I had a camera with me, he just sits down. Whenever I get the camera and start taking pictures, I look around and he's just sat there. He's just waiting.
So Andy, the question is, you know, we talked a little bit about German agriculture, and I know that we have a large farm network.
We do,
so where is this biodiversity farm network for? What are the benefits and what do we do then?
So we have a series of farms across Europe.
Mm-hmm.
They're not BASF farms, they're independently run farms where we work with landowners, farmers, and we work with third parties like NGOs or universities. Where we do these sorts of experimentation is the wrong word, demonstration.
Yeah.
Is we see the farms very much as an outdoor classroom.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I could show you all of this on a PowerPoint in an office. I bring you out here and I show exactly. So, and what we also tend to do is try and get peer-to-peer discussions going. Mm-hmm. So it's always better if a farmer can speak with a farmer and say, yeah, look, I've had this for 10 years. I've done this amount of work on it, but the benefits that I've seen have been what's going on over there, yeah, for example.
Because he wants to see the profitability.
Sure,
right?
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Are farmers afraid of, let's say, taking up biodiversity?
No, I think most farmers that I know see biodiversity as it's a physical indicator of the health of their farm.
Okay.
So if they saw nothing, they didn't see any birds, they didn't see any insects, I think they would be extremely worried.
Okay.
So most farmers will tend to have an active interest in what's going on, number one. Most farmers do field walks. They walk around their farm. They're there every day.
It's their asset.
It's their asset, so they see things. Mm-hmm. So they know where the skylarks are nesting in the field. They know where the badgers are. They know what biodiversity is going on in the bits that they're working with to support it.
But how do you if you just look, for example, into the US, we see pictures of large soybean fields, miles after miles of cornfields. And how do we, play biodiversity here?
There is no, I would argue, I've been working in this area now for 10 years. There is no silver bullet.
Okay.
Number one. And number two, whatever you put in place has to work for the farmer. Mm-hmm. So I can't give a general answer, but if I was to walk onto a large US farm, I think we would already find various bits where biodiversity is thriving, because there's woods. They like to hunt, they like to shoot. The question is then, how do we find and work with them to interconnect them, so that they're not isolated bits of biodiversity? Mm. So that's number one. Number two, though, I'm passionate about soil and soil health. I think it all starts with the soil. And in the US, even on a big farm, you've got to have a healthy soil.
Yeah. Well, and we had this dust bowl in the 30s and 40s, right?
Exactly.
Where erosion was the topic number one,
yeah,
of soil really eroding when the wind came and the dryness.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe just talking about it, and this is one of the hottest days we are currently experiencing.
Yes, yes, yeah.
It will be even hotter, and of course climate and weather are two different things, but do you see biodiversity and climate change interconnected? We talked about different flowering species, of course they will adapt,
mm-hmm,
but biodiversity, the role in climate change?
Yes, but I don't think you can just single out biodiversity. Climate change will affect biodiversity. We have it. We have our own data where we've seen that in northern Germany, we're increasingly seeing spiders, mm-hmm, that 10 years ago we only found in southern France.
Okay.
They've already moved up through Germany. So biodiversity, I think, will adapt, because if you give nature a home, it will come. But where we can play a significant role is what's going on here under the soil, because we're sucking out carbon dioxide. I mean, this is the simple biology. Sunlight, carbon dioxide, goes into plant. Yeah. If we can keep it in the soil and we can pull out more CO2, then yeah.
Pull it out of the atmosphere, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we're also in the middle, well, the last year and the year before in parts of Germany and Central Europe, record-breaking droughts.
Yeah.
It's the first time we've ever seen two consecutive years of such dry weather. And
you see it in the forest, right?
You saw it, yeah.
Just dramatic impact on the forest and this one.
But the models tell us even a simple reduction in CO2 will break that cycle.
Yeah.
So, yes, we do have to do a lot, but even doing simple things, we might start to see almost immediate benefits.
Okay. But I think also, no, let's go maybe to the global aspect as well. We have programs like the monarch butterfly, for example,
sure,
in the US,
yeah,
the Mata Viva, you know, deforestation program in Brazil. Are these programs somewhat coordinated, or does, you know, everybody does its best, and how do we work on this?
No, we do try to coordinate them, again, through the farm network. I mean, we have physical farms in Europe, and Sometimes we refer to it as the European farm network, but actually it's not. It is global, because it's wherever we are doing activities with third parties to support biodiversity. To me, that's part of our network. And there is the opportunity within the network for best practice sharing. You may ask, yeah, but you know, whatever goes on here, how's it going to affect monarch butterflies in the US? Yes, yeah. So you'd be surprised. Even down to simple things like how do you prepare the ground? Mm-hmm. Because if we want to plant one of these things from scratch, what we really got to be careful of is controlling the weeds that are already in the soil, because we don't want this full of grass.
Of course. Otherwise you cause the problem on the other side in terms of benefits, right?
Exactly. And the grass in the first couple of years will just swamp all of this and it will die. So it's simple agronomic stuff that a normal farmer would apply in a wheat field needs to also be applied here. And we apply that learning then across our global network, as an example.
And you said you were working together with universities, experts, institutions to help us to find, let's say, the right biodiversity farming practices. Are we also working together, let's say, with flower seed producers to have the right mixtures to offer? Or how do farmers at the end of the day say, oh, you tell me all this stuff, but how do I get these real endemic seeds?
In certain countries, yes, we are. Yeah. In Germany, we do. In the UK, we do. We work with a flower company to ensure that we provide, or the farmer has access to, the right seed mixture. But the first question you need to ask the farmer is, what is it you want to attract? Mm-hmm. What is your key performance indicator for what you're doing well? Is it birds? And a lot of farmers in the UK, it's farmland birds. And the problem that we've had since 1970 in the UK is because we move from planting our crops in the spring to now planting them in the winter, that there is a gap for the birds between, we call it the hunger gap, that goes from December through to March, where basically they starve, and if there's no food, they disappear. So the farmer says, I want my farmland birds back. So then we work with him and get a mix here that provides the seeds for that hunger gap.
Okay.
But if he's after insects, or he's after dragonflies or butterflies, then we find a different mixture.
You mentioned birds, and maybe you can help us, because you know we're working on an initiative. I think it works under the project name Larkbread.
Yes.
And maybe what about Larkbread? I know a little bit about it, but maybe somebody else may also be interested, because it seems that we are not only farming biodiversity, but we're also farming our farm value in a different way, monetary value.
Sure. So Larkbread, or Lerchenbrot in German?
Lerchenbrot
in German.
I think we shouldn't call it Larkbread. I think we should call it Larkloaf.
Or a Larkloaf. I mean, again, a very typical European farmland bird is the skylark. If you walk through a field on a summer day, you hear them singing way up high. They nest in wheat fields, but what they need is almost like a little runway. If the field is completely covered in growing crops, they can't land.
Okay.
So we are...
Which can't nest.
Which means they can't nest, yeah, because they nest in the field. So we've worked with the value chain. So right, the people, or the baker who produces the bread, we're working with farmers, we're bringing our own innovation. And again, it comes back to the discussion we were talking about a field not yielding uniformly. If we can identify a patch in a field, and we can through using digital, where the yield is lower, then we would suggest to the farmer that they just turn off the seeder.
Yeah.
As they go over it, and you leave a bare patch of a few meters.
That's a famous window.
That's right? The window. Okay. So when the bird's way up there, it looks down, it sees its window, it comes in and lands, and then runs off to its nest. But what we've done is we've started to be able to connect all the dots and generate value for that, because I, as a member of society, I'm happy to pay a little bit more for something that I know has been produced with a biodiversity type in mind. So that's that added value is being passed back through the baker to the farmer and to everyone that's involved in it, so that it's generating revenue over and above what the farmer loses by having a bare patch in the middle of his field.
So we as consumers are, well, I know I'm willing, I know you are willing, and most likely the baker also sees there is a willingness to do that. We pay biodiversity, and therefore generating an additional value stream for the farmer, and as you said, most likely on areas which is anyhow less productive than other areas.
Exactly.
So in principle, he's overvaluing this part. I don't know if this is the right English word for it. You judge.
No, but in principle, yeah. I mean, it's actually, again, it's optimizing what he is farming for. I'm a passionate believer that in the future, and it'll be, to me, it's the near future, that a farmer does no longer just farms crops. He farms a whole variety of different things. It's wheat, but maybe it's value added wheat for skylarks. It's biodiversity, it's carbon, it's soil health, it's all sorts of different things.
So it comes back to the complexity, and we had this in our first discussion, saying farmers are faced with a completely different way to farm, much more complex, to have societal demands in there. Maybe sometimes they are values, sometimes they are also some more demands from that. It's resources, as you said, it's climate change, biodiversity, and all technology. You mentioned digitalization.
Sure.
All into it. Huh?
Yeah. But there's also a flip side to this, and it's very interesting because we shouldn't also forget where we've come from. So I was standing having a very similar conversation next to one of these with an elderly German man in East Germany.
Yeah, okay.
Just outside of Berlin. And he said to me, this is rubbish. He said, when I was a child, I used to go hungry. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't forget that we need, as a society, we need to continue to have cheap and nutritious food. Mm. The argumentation.
And affordable,
yeah. Yeah. So the argumentation then is, well, yes, but we've got to balance it.
Yeah.
And we've got to do it within the planetary limitations that we find today.
And of course, as you're right, depending where you are, the yield optimization in terms of, tonnage is key because carbohydrates are really needed.
Exactly, right? Yeah.
And I think on the other end, you also can demonstrate that you increase, and that's what we learned, increase the yield on those fields based on, selective high-value biodiversity farming.
Exactly.
Not just do some flower strips, it looks nice and we will feel happy if you walk through the poppy field, but really something which is dedicated.
Exactly, yeah.
How do you, we have normal crop protection on the other field.
Mm-hmm.
How does this impact your biodiversity?
I think it works both ways. Number one is that yes, we have modern crop protection on the other fields, mm-hmm. which, as you know, as they are developed, they are looked at very critically, and we know the profile that those products have when they are applied. And I think it's fair to say that most of the modern stuff we produce is much more benign than what was being produced in the 70s. So that's number one. But number two, we talk with the farmer and we talk about stewardship and we talk about responsible use. And if he was spraying, for example, an insecticide, we'd ask him not to spray right up close.
Okay. So
there's a buffer. We'd also talk to him about the wind conditions. There's a little bit of wind around today.
Okay.
If it was windy, he shouldn't. Now, all of that I know is relying very much on the farmer, but we are seeing moves within the whole digital space that we can actually automate all of this. And that to me is also very exciting. But the other thing is working the other way back. This is full of parasitoidal wasps. That field is full of aphids. The wasps eat the aphids. So actually, in reality, the farmer's probably having to spray less if he's got
Based on the threshold of aphids, where he says normally I would spray because I see a yield loss, right?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So I mean, it goes both ways, and I think modern farming is beneficial to biodiversity, and biodiversity is of course beneficial to modern farming.
But Andy, if you have now a wish, let's say, unfortunately with the weather, it's not close to Christmas. but what would be your wish? What would you or your vision? How you would see biodiversity developing?
My vision is it relates, I think, to a culture change. A lot of farmers, rightly or wrongly, always want to farm from the hedge to the hedge to the hedge to the hedge. I'm a farmer. That's my job.
Yeah. And my land.
And it's my land. And I've got to earn money for it. If we can work more and more as BASF and as an industry with actually identifying the most productive bits for wheat or for soya or for corn, but then demonstrate to the farmer that actually it's a win-win if he puts the other bits to biodiversity. Mm-hmm. And my if I can dream, I would love to see 5% of an average farm turned over to biodiversity. Yeah. And actually, in reality, I'm sure you could do that, because more than 5% of an average farm today is probably uneconomic to farm.
Which would be, in principle, one question is, do you want to incentivize this? Or is it something where you say, come on, it has to be obligatory, mandatory, be it on labels, etc., etc.?
No, I think at the end of the day, also, I'm not a farmer, so it's not my business. I mean, it has to make financial sense to the farmer. And I think if we can demonstrate that not farming actually immediately makes financial sense, that ticks one box. But if we're doing it because we as society want it, we want to see more birds, we want to see more butterflies, then we as a society also have to think hard about how we pay for that.
So the lark bread is maybe one attempt, how society, let's say,
so
values biodiversity, but it's most likely a pilot which can hopefully be scaled and demonstrate the value, but I think it's not all of that. Right?
And it's not just biodiversity, because on the biodiversity journey, as we've been discussing coming down here, lots of other stuff is going on as well. So if we're farming biodiversity, we're actually also farming carbon. So as part of my dream is that maybe we start to see a functioning carbon market developing for agriculture, because there is a lot of carbon down there. Maybe not on this soil, because it's sandy, but on most loamy soils, we've already got 40 tons of carbon per hectare stored.
And of course we know carbon emissions from agriculture are, at least to a certain degree, a part of what we see now on the climate debate.
Exactly. But we can also work, again, as part of this whole concept of never seeing bare soil, if we can start improving the fertility of the soil, we can more precisely apply our fertilizers and reduce our emissions.
And fertility is a proxy for carbon at the end.
Exactly.
To a certain degree. So we stood here in the shades because we know it's pretty warm.
It's hot. Well, the dog,
yeah, Charlie is always, I think, looking for some water now to drink. Thanks, Andy.
Thank you.
For being with me. And thanks for answering most of the questions. We will sure see it again. I see also biodiversity further and further developing. Thanks for all your insight.
Thank you for visiting, which was my safe space in lockdown. When I was getting really frustrated about being stuck at home all the time, I used to bring Charlie down here of an evening, and it's just beautiful. It's paradise.
And we follow you on Twitter. I know Charlie and you are very often there, either with nice pictures or sometimes also with some interesting movies.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thanks.
BASF. We create chemistry.